morning, good morning. Welcome to the Brenda Perryman Show right here on TV 33, WHPR, Comcast 91 in Detroit, and all over the world, courtesy of the World Wide Web. And we also have the app for your cell phone. I am excited to be here today, but before I begin, I'd like to, of course, extend my condolences to Aretha Franklin's family, to her friends, to all of us who are mourning her passing. She's been a part of the music of our lives. I know, listening to Respect as a teenager and just everything, and Ain't No Way was my favorite song, but time marches on, fortunately or unfortunately, and we've lost an icon, but her legacy will live on forever. Welcome to the show, everyone. This morning we have a few laughs, and then we have some young people who are very, very inspirational, and I can't wait to have them on my second segment. My first segment, I have a young man who is just not only reaching for the stars, he is a star. I have Jeffrey Horst, or Jeff Horst. You want it, Jeff Horst? Yeah.
Jeff or Jeffrey, whatever you want to call me, it's fine.
But don't call you late for dinner. Yeah, I know all of that. But, you know, Jeff is a comedian. He was very quiet in high school, but now he's getting ready to star in a comedy special, right?
Yep, my first half-hour comedy special.
Wow, on the Comedy Central.
Yep, on Comedy Central, next Friday, August 24th.
And who is it presented by?
It's Kevin Hart. It's called Kevin Hart Presents The Next Level. And,
wow.
So it'll start off with him interviewing me for a couple minutes, and then it'll go on to my half-hour special.
Oh, this is... how was it? Did you...
It was
already
great. We already filmed it, yeah. It was great. I had a great time. The staff and everybody behind it treated me fantastic. I couldn't have asked for a better experience.
Wow. Well, let's see how you prepared yourself for that, because I know there are somebody watching this. You know, I find that there's so many funny people around, but to put it on stage and mm-hmm. do it and let your comedy manifest itself is a whole different story, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely, because it definitely, people present the comedian as being this insanely outgoing person, and sometimes they're a little bit more reserved for the stage. So,
wow. Well, you know, Jeff, I'm so proud of you because, you know, I had Jessica. Uh-huh. I had your sister and brother. Your brother played Franklin Roosevelt in one of my plays.
He did.
He played Franklin Roosevelt. Isn't that something? But I just never knew that you would take to that. Mm-hmm. When did you think you were funny? Did people tell you?
People told me that I was funny and that I should do stand-up, but I was always nervous. I was the type of person, the first time I took speech, I failed.
You sure did.
So I was always funny to the person right next to me in class, but I was never the class clown. I didn't want to make an example or make a big scene or anything like that. So I always knew I was funny, but I never knew that I would be funny in that environment until a friend of mine kind of encouraged me to go to an open mic that she was a waitress at.
Sometimes do you just think funny things?
Yeah, that's how it all starts. You know, most of the writing that most comics, I'd say, do just kind of comes out of just writing down, typing in your phone something that you see happening right now, you know.
Listen to that, typing in your phone.
Yeah.
Richard Pryor didn't type into a phone.
I don't know how he did it.
You don't know how he
without,
did it?
Without phones, that's crazy.
Oh, please. There was a thing once called a pen and a paper.
Yeah.
And then some people are just funny off the top of their heads, you know. And I was voted class clown.
You were?
Yes. I was a fool, and you know. Seriously, my father was funny, my kids are funny, everybody's just funny, but nobody went into being a comedian. You know, and mm-hmm. this is the highest art form, because what you have to bank on people laughing to uh-huh. be successful.
Yeah.
Have you ever bombed?
Oh, yeah, everybody's bombed. And anybody who tells you they haven't bombed is lying. So that's good to know. Just see. So there's definitely a big learning curve in the beginning where that's why some people don't get started in comedy that want to, is they want everything to be perfect before they do it. And it's definitely something that you just have to fall flat on your face and just learn through the experience, because there's certain things that you can never prepare for. And some jokes, just you have to work them out on stage in front of a real crowd before you can perfect them.
Yeah. Have you ever had any jokes that you said, wow, this is going to be the bomb. I'm going to save this for last. It's going to blow them away. Has that ever happened?
Yeah. Yeah. Sometimes you have good feelings about a joke before you say it, and sometimes you're right and sometimes you're wrong. So
now, since the last time you were here, you've been traveling more, haven't you?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, definitely. I've been traveling a lot more. The shows that I've been doing, I did a show called, before this, I did another show with Kevin Hart called Kevin Hart Presents Heart of the City.
Right.
And where they showcased, me and three other comics in Detroit. And
yeah, because
that's helped me get on the road a lot.
Who was in that? Looking right at him.
J-Bell?
Yeah.
J-Bell, Michael Jeter, and Alton Williams, Boogie. And,
right.
And it was, yeah, that was great as well. So that kind of started the process of me being able to get this half hour show, because it was with the same producers. And
wow, that was great.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I think about the fact that you went to a majority minority school.
Mm-hmm.
And you use that in your comedy, don't you?
Yeah, that's a very big influence in my comedy, because I was more comfortable telling jokes in the black rooms before the white rooms, because the black rooms represented my friends. It just seemed to be more comfortable of the setting that I would, in school, tell jokes to, where the white rooms, I didn't tell jokes as often to my cousins, you know?
Right.
I didn't hang out with them
you
as often.
You told jokes to my cousins.
Yeah.
You told the jokes to them. What inspired those jokes? Or you just, you know, because you did some comparisons. I think some of yours deal with comparison. Can you give me an example of that?
A lot of my jokes stem from real life, or just my perspective on it. And growing up as white in a majority black community was definitely just my outlook on it. And
what were some of the differences between maybe our culture and your culture?
And I know that there's also like a location aspect of this too, but especially in the Midwest, I feel like I think that there's some parenting differences of the way that what you can get away with talking to your parents. I think that there's definitely instilled a little bit more of a fear of cursing at a black mother as opposed to a white mother.
Right. Oh, really? Yeah.
So you know, and obviously every household can be a little bit different, but that's just, you know, I do have jokes that
because you touch will on get that. Slapped down with a black mother, you know, and then you know, what could you talk back to a white mother more?
I see that happening a lot more often, you know, and I'm sure people see that sometimes just in public at stores where you'll hear children, you're like, why is she letting him talk to her like that?
Right. Absolutely. Now, you know, in my family, it's kind of multicultural because my daughter-in-law is white and, of course, my son is black. But the thing about it is they were giving the kids timeouts.
Oh.
And I said, a timeout didn't work on you, and it will not work on your kids. And next thing I know, but he says, Mom, we have to be civilized. I said, okay, civilized. Next thing I know, I was visiting, and he was whooping him up the stairs. He was like, honey, please.
He said, I tried the timeout, but that was just like
but
recess.
Then, you know, started talking back, you know, and said, no. What are any other cultural differences between your friends, your black friends and your white friends?
I sometimes look for differences. Sometimes there's not as much differences as some people may think.
Right.
So sometimes when I know that there's a lot of white comedians that don't do the black rooms, and I think that sometimes they're overthinking it, where they think that it's an entirely different world. I really think that it's a lot of extra stuff that they're putting in their head, because sometimes it's just go tell jokes
and
say it with some confidence, and you'll be fine.
No, I think a lot of white comedians are funny.
I think they are funny. Yeah.
Now, I don't think Kevin Hart's that funny.
I'm not allowed to disagree with you on that. I'm not allowed to agree with you.
I mean, you said it wrong.
Yeah, I said it wrong.
No, I just, you know, that's just me. You know, sometimes I like more low-key funny, you know, I do. Yeah. And then I like the physical comedy of, I'm going to talk about this historical figure of a Richard Pryor who I used to see in person, and his body, how he used his body on some of his stuff, and then he talked about himself. You know, when he got burned up that time. Yeah.
Personal stories can absolutely, you know, the most tragic things. If you can find a way to make humor in that, then you can relate to so many people that could also be going through something like that.
Absolutely. Now, do you ever tell personal?
Yeah, yeah. I've gotten a lot more personal the longer that I've done comedy. Because when I started from the aspect of just think of things that are funny and say them on stage, like the pure basics. And then the longer you do it, the further you get with it, the more that you want yourself to be represented more accurately in your act. And so I have started to tell more stories involving my family and, you know, personal experiences that I've
had.
So.
Right. Have you ever got stopped by the police?
Yeah. I remember the first time I got paid. The first time I got paid on a show was a comedian named Fago Red.
Fago Red. Red Pop.
It was my first time I got paid at a show. And on the way home, I think I was going. I was speeding. I was going a little bit over 5.
You were happy.
I was happy. I wasn't like crazy speeding. You know what I mean? But I was still speeding. And he asked me why I was speeding, and I thought that honesty would help. And it actually did in that situation. I told him it was my first time getting paid on a comedy show. He looked at me like I was weird, but he let me off. So.
Oh, well, that's.
I mean,
cool.
I've had other incidences with the police, but I mean, this is the TV-friendly one. You know, we can.
What was the first room you ever played?
The first open mic I ever did, it was at Big Ten Burrito in Ann Arbor. And. a girl that worked there, who I'm friends with, she was the one who asked me to do a show there. And my family, my friends came out, and it was definitely the perfect environment to go on stage for the first time because everybody's new. Nobody's good enough to outshine you because everybody's new together, so you're not going to feel weird, you know, by just doing okay. And everything kind of just started from there. You know, one comic knows of another room to go to and word of mouth, and then you kind of just mingle.
Well, I've seen you on stage, and you are funny. And, you know, the thing about it is you know how to diversify.
Yes.
You know how to diversify your jokes. You know how to, I mean, you're so user-friendly to me.
I mean,
seriously, because some people who haven't seen you may say, now, what is he going to say? You know, I mean, seriously.
Yeah.
You know,
absolutely.
Comedy critics are some of the toughest critics, don't you think?
Yeah. There's definitely people that, because they have a sense of humor, they just assume that, They kind of come into the situation assuming that they're funnier than you, whether they heckle you, whether they talk or not, they definitely still have that in the back of their mind, and so that goes into play a lot. Where if they think that they're funnier than you, then you really have to impress them and start off the gate with, you know, some really great material.
Have you ever had a heckler?
Yes, I've had a lot of hecklers. It gets easier to handle hecklers the more that the better you're doing, because if you're doing poorly and somebody heckles you, then nobody in the audience is on your side.
Have you ever been on stage doing your comedy and it's just not going the way you want, and you say, God, I want to just get off the stage, I want to run?
Yeah, and you can't run. You got to finish your time.
You got to finish.
you got to dig out of that hole some way, whether you do some crowd work, whether you sometimes just acknowledging how bad you're doing, you know, making it not, it can be more awkward
if you're doing
poorly. And the audience
can turn into your friend.
Yeah, because if you're doing poorly and everybody knows it and you're just a robot and you're just going through the jokes, acting like nothing is happening differently, then that's not good. So it's definitely good to be loose on stage and show some personality.
So with this next level. You get to do. When is this coming on, by the way?
It's coming out next Friday, a week from today, Friday, August 24th at 11 o'clock.
God, I'm going to watch it. You know,
yeah.
Well, of course, we want everyone from here to watch it because he represents us. He represents the D. And I'm so excited. How did you feel when you found out you qualified for this?
It was amazing. I felt fantastic. It was recently, you know, within, you know, several months after I filmed The Heart of the City. So I was still riding the high from the first time.
Uh-huh.
So it was even better news. And it was filmed out in L.A. at the Orpheum Theater.
Really?
Yeah, beautiful theater.
Yeah.
They flew me out there, treated me nice. So the entire experience, I'll never forget.
Wow. So where would you like to see yourself in 5 years?
Huh. You know what? I'm planning on eventually moving out to L.A. I don't have a specific date set with that. But I definitely want to try to take it, you know, as you know, especially a couple of shows with Kevin Hart. You know, I feel like I might as well try to take this as far as I can.
Right, you might as well try and ride that momentum.
Yeah, I might as well try to ride this momentum.
Tell me about Kevin Hart.
He's a really nice guy. I did a few interviews with him. So for me, the first time they messed up some of the audio or equipment, so we had to do it again. It was frustrating from his perspective, you know, because he had places in the time schedule because he's a busy man.
Because he's made 20 movies this year.
But for me, it was like, all right, well, whatever. I get to talk to Kevin Hart for another 15 minutes, you know.
Right.
But he was very nice. He was very funny. And he's just, you know, him reaching out to comedians that he definitely doesn't have to. He definitely doesn't need this extra money that the show was providing. Is definitely, it shows to me what a comedian in his position can do. You know, when you have a lot of money and you've grown up in a certain culture, giving back to people is amazing. You know, obviously it's helped my career.
Yeah, it has. But you know, this is hard work. People shouldn't act like this is not hard work.
Oh yeah, he does. I don't think he sleeps. You know, I check out him on social media, and he's training for a marathon while he's in a couple movies, while he runs a couple shows, while he's doing a couple commercials.
Right.
So, and he still does stand up. So it's like he has a full schedule that he just doesn't stop. But when you enjoy what you're doing, it's very easy.
Well, I admire the fact that he's helping other up and coming comedians too.
Mm-hmm.
We have a quick phone call. Good morning.
Well, happy Friday to both of you.
Oh, thank you.
I'm calling because at the beginning of your interview, you mentioned majority, minority, and then I understand your guest is saying that he was comfortable performing to a black audience, and I think that's wonderful. It is something that we need, where we have people of different ethnic backgrounds able to be comfortable with each other. But I take issue with the term majority, minority. You know, if you perform and you were comfortable with Chinese, would you say majority, minority, or majority Chinese?
I really don't know.
Well, I bring it up because in California, San Diego, I guess it was, the Mexicans had the council change the law because that same term was used out there. So they have a law on the book that talks about majority Mexicans as opposed to majority, you know.
Well, I think that's a good point, Theo. I just was going to say too that it was a majority black school.
Right.
It was a majority black school. In fact, his sister played Dina in Dreamgirls in 2000. She played Dina. She earned the role and did an excellent job. And I really appreciate you bringing that to my attention.
Sure.
Okay.
We got to be proud of being black American.
Oh, please. Yes. Yes. That's the only thing I know. All righty, then. Thanks a million.
You're welcome.
Uh-huh. So, Mm-hmm. Next Friday, the 24th.
Yep, Friday, August 24th at 11 o'clock. You can also watch it on the Comedy Central website or the Comedy Central app. It'll be on there as well, so you can. There's different ways to watch it. I'm also having a viewing party if anybody wants to watch it live when I watch it. I'll be at Zeke's Barbecue in Ferndale.
Oh yeah,
right off of 9 in Woodward.
Right,
so,
I know exactly.
So if you guys, if anybody wants to come on out, that's where I'll be watching it.
Wow, wow, that's close to my house. Well, Jeff, you saw him here first, so when you see him on national stuff, say just don't forget us here.
Hey, I can't.
Just don't. But if you need any acting coaching, you know I'm here.
Absolutely.
All right. So everybody, just wait. We're going to be right back with some young people.
Happy to be here. I'm from Detroit. I went to school growing up. With a couple of white people. I went to school with the type of white people that didn't know they were white. You know what I'm talking about? One guy used to wear FUBU. And be like, listen, buddy. That's not for us. Or by us, actually. You wear do-rags and stuff. I'm like, our hair doesn't even do that. What are you... He's putting Murray's grease in his hair, holding a dye-in brush. I'm gonna be honest. I don't even know what those last two things are. for that joke, I just go with stuff only black people mess with. And I get called white boy a lot, cause I look like this, and. I get called white boy a lot, but this is my issue. It's like, I'm 29 years old. How old do you have to be to graduate from white boy to white man? You know? It's getting embarrassing at this point. Like, I feel like I could die at the age of 95, and some of my best black friends will be at the funeral, and they'll just be like, man, it's so sad. He was such a cool white boy. Like, still? I can't... It was 95. That's not enough to be... You don't have to be a white man at that point. Lived a long life. Let's get to know each other a little bit. Who in here is married? Clap if you're married. A lot of people, that's cool. I was asking because a friend of mine the other day proposed to his girlfriend. Yeah, he had a nice, big, beautiful ring. It was romantic, you know? And then she, of course, said no. Yeah, that's awkward. And that makes me scared to ask the question someday, you know what I mean? Because I have to have a plan B for everything in life. That's why if I ever ask a woman to marry me, it's on April 1st. I'm not looking stupid. April Fool's chick, whatever. I'm not gonna look dumb here. I love to visit my grandparents whenever I can. I think everybody should visit their grandparents whenever they can. I was over at my grandma's house the other day, and I always love talking to him. He's always interesting. He was like, when I was your age, we were so poor, we had to put water in our cereal. Well, that's disgusting, Grandpa. Fun fact about cereal, you can have it plain. It's good right out of the box there, Gramps. Don't know if you're poor. I do know you made poor decisions. Eating that soggy cereal. Nobody told you you had to eat that. When I was your age, gas was so cheap, they gave us a dollar. Shut up, Grandpa. That never happened. You never made money getting gasoline. That's where I draw the line. I love you, but no. So when I was your age, we didn't have book bags. We had to carry our books to school. Great. Sounds like somebody like you should have invented a book bag. Grandpa, have you looked at the amount of books that kids have had to take to school ever since you left school? Every year, and you parents know this because you're shoving the books in the kids' book bags, they get more books and heavier books that they have to take to school. Like when I was going to school, I used to have like 2 50-pound books per class. What did you have, Grandpa? You had the school book. Just one book. called The School Book. And half of history didn't happen yet, so it wasn't even that heavy. Your three-page book with one president. I don't care. Fold it up, put it in your back pocket. Like, what? It'd be an easier way to take it to school. I'm broke. Anybody else in here broke? Clap if you're broke. Yeah. I owe a lot of money in student loan debt that I don't care to ever pay back. And I owe so much money that to me the number looks imaginary. You guys know what I'm talking about? Anybody ever own an imaginary amount of money? Somebody tried to collect some of it the other day. He gave me a call. He's like, is this Jeffrey Horst? Is this Jeffrey?
Welcome back to the Brenda Perryman Show right here on TV 33, WHPR, Comcast 91 in Detroit, and all over the world, courtesy of the World Wide Web. And I have Dennis Foster here. He's the coach of
Change the Mentality.
Put the mic up so that they can hear you. And I have Marcus Green, videographer, producer, and all of that, who brought them to our attention. So, Marcus, why don't you kind of start off talking about this? And we have young people in the studio that I will be highlighting shortly.
Well, it started out for me. I don't even know how I stumbled across it. I mean, like I said before when I've been on your show previously, I'm just looking for the best, most inspirational stories I can find out of the Metro Detroit area. And I came across this basketball team actually through Twitter, I believe it was, and I reached out to the publicist who created their Twitter channel, and I looked up the website, and I got a hold of Dennis, and we talked on the phone, and we hit it off right away. You know, his ideology about where he wants to see the youth in this city go, and me documenting that just fell hand in hand, and I've just been trying to be a resource ever since and get them as known as possible with what they're doing.
Absolutely. And you had met with some struggles, right?
Yes.
Oh, why don't you talk about it, Dennis?
We had a gym.
Louder.
We had a gym over on Otter Drive and
Gratiot,
the old Rosa Park Middle School, and it recently got burned down. We got burned down 2 years ago, and we don't practice. We haven't had a place to practice. That was our home. And that was my place of employment, too, as well, because I was running the gym and it got burned down. So it was just a terrible situation to happen.
Okay. I know it was devastating.
Yes.
And then you didn't have a gym. And then what did you do? Because you had these boys. I mean, maybe not these boys. They grow up and go away, right?
Right. But with the kids, we stuck at it. We kept going. We went outside and practiced. We practiced during games. Then it was just me. The teaching that I gave them when we did have a gym, it just stuck with them. So it was just an easy transition, but it was hard.
I know it was hard, but you know, you thought it was important because of what? What did it do for the young men?
It gave them a sense of urgency. It gave them a sense of pride. Of all the work they've put in, so when the situation happened, they didn't hold their head. They stood up stronger, and it pushed them out. Even made things even easier for them on the floor because they was working towards something.
Right, and the reason why you want to do this for these young men is not just the idea of basketball. It's more to it. Basketball is more than a game.
Yes, it's a way of life. I use basketball for them as a platform, and that platform can send them anywhere in the world. And that's the situation I came through. Basketball was my platform. I've been all over the world playing basketball, and they can use it for whatever they want. In today's society, you can use basketball or a sport or is for anything you want in any place you want to get in the world.
Yes, and not only that, don't you think it enables young people to know about the team concept, and there's no I in team, right?
Yeah, most
and
definitely.
You can't do it by yourself.
Not at all.
And it does carry over into your adult life, doesn't it?
Yes, absolutely. Ma'am. Yeah, I just seeing them in the way that he holds them accountable for everything that they do reminds me of how I grew up in sports, and that's why it makes it so easy to tell their story, even though what they've gone through
is some of the hardest thing. I mean, so many people would have given up by now, you know, with what Dennis has done, what he's had to do to get these guys together, and not only to play in this city, but to also take it outside of the city and showcase their talents nationwide.
That's what I'm so impressed with, because, I mean, how many people are on the team?
We have 10 kids.
10 children, I mean, young people on the team. And you played out in Las Vegas, right?
Yes, we just recently got back from the Fab 48 tournament in Las Vegas.
That is amazing. Against so many odds. I mean, do you have a gym now to practice?
No.
Not now either?
No.
Why is that? Nobody's giving you access, or are you asking? Tell me.
I'm asking, but the prices, the prices are outrageous to rent a gym nowadays. It's like $50, $60 an hour.
You're kidding.
So with my kids, I'm asking parents to help out on travel and things like that. It'd end up being another bill for the parents at the end of the week. $5 for practice, gas money to get them to practice, and things like that. And I don't want basketball to be a bill for the parent, because it's about teaching and not paying for everything.
Absolutely. And you know that, and I know that busy children don't get in trouble.
Exactly.
And I think that's very important. Don't you?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
What is the character of this team?
What a character.
I think you may think they're kind of funny. Yes. I mean, they have a sense of humor.
Yeah, the kids are great. The kids are great, but the character goes into the name, change the mentality.
Change the mentality.
So with the changing of the mentality, it's I allow them to be themselves, but as Marcus said, I hold them accountable. So I give them the freedom to be a kid and to grow, but along the way, I'm going to hold you accountable for every move, step, situation that you're in.
Right. Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, we're going to go to a quick break, and I'm hoping we could show the video. We're going to go to the quick break, and I'm going to bring a couple of the guys up.
Okay.
And so that I could talk to two of the guys with you. And we'll be right back. We're going to do a quick break. If you're watching on Facebook Live, you won't be able to see the video. You can watch it if you look at WHPR.com, live, watch live. You can see it.
I mean, it make it even better because you got a son that's coming up with him. You know what I'm saying? I mean, everybody into it, but you doing something that's big, man. That might take you a long way. That's a blessing, bro, for real.
I am back. I'm here with two gentlemen, Day-Day.
James.
And James. Put the mic up and speak loud. Projection must be your life. Right. Now, gentlemen, how old are you?
I'm 13.
And I'm 15.
13 and 15. Okay, and you play what position?
I play shooting guard.
Shooting guard, speak up, speak up. What we talk about. And you play?
I play point guard.
Point guard, point guard. Oh, I remember a few good point guards, Isaiah and some others. I mean, they're good point guards. Isn't the guy from Golden State a point guard?
Steph Curry.
Yeah, I know his name. I know his name in real life, but I just wanted you to say it. Steph Curry's a point guard, right?
Yes.
He's a good one. Now, you got to talk into the mic or I'm going to go to a break. Okay, you got to, because I want my audience to hear you. I don't want to have to do all the talking because I can.
Exactly, get them.
Tell me about these two young men.
Okay, I've been coaching James and Day-Day since second, third grade. So I've had these kids majority of their basketball careers. James, these are two of, like, this is the toughest kid on our team.
Day-Day?
Day-Day is the toughest kid on our team. He's the heart and soul, the toughest kid. Check anybody. We don't care if he's 6'7". He's going at him. James is the leader. He don't lead with vocals, but he leads by his actions on the floor and off the floor. And both of these kids are outstanding student athletes.
Oh, that's excellent. That's excellent. So you lead by example, James.
Yes.
So what do you want to be when you grow up? When I say that, I'm not discounting the league or anything like that or playing college. I'm not discounting that, but are there any other careers you like?
I want to be a scientist or a chemical engineer.
Oh, excellent. What about you, Day-Day?
If I don't make it, I'm going to end up going back to school and find my major that I want to be.
Oh, you're going to explore.
Yes.
Okay, good. Now, remember I told you my Facebook people have to hear you, huh?
Speak up.
Uh-huh. So, well, that's good because it's good to look forward the future because, and you know, one thing about it, playing with this team and the struggles that you have had has made you stronger, don't you think?
Yes.
In what regard?
What are the things that people have that you don't have? Other teams.
A basketball gym.
They can practice.
They have practices but in gyms, but what do you have that stands out to make you all so good?
A family. We stick together.
Speak into the mic.
We stick together. It's like we've been together for a lot of years, so we know each other. And, like, we could talk to each other and our coach. Like, our coach is like another dad to us. He's been there for a long time to help us do things that our parents do and he do. So he helps us, really.
Now, we saw a clip, a basketball game. What was that?
That was in L.A.
Oh, in Los Angeles?
Yes, ma'am.
Whoa, from no gym to Los Angeles. I'll be dog. That's a testament to you. It's a testament to these young people also. And what does this upcoming season look like? Now, are you going to be playing? Now, do they play for the school?
Yes,
too?
All of them will be attending Hamtramck High School.
Hamtramck High School. And then after the season, then you all start? Or?
Yes, ma'am. But we really never stop. But after the season, after the high school season, we go right back into it. And what I've been doing with the kids is going up by age. That's why it's so easy when you was talking about what do they have that a lot of teams don't have. We don't have a lot of kids coming in. It's them, and I stick with them. And they're going to ride it out, win or lose. We're going to ride it out together all the way through.
All right. I love it. I love that. That's so important because – after you finish your basketball careers, you've learned a lot about teamwork. You've learned how to be, to work together to achieve a high standard. You know, it's a testament to your coaching ability and to their talent, too.
Yes, ma'am.
That they've gotten so far.
And their understanding it goes hand in hand.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does. You can't do it without them, and they can't do it without you.
Exactly.
Oh, I love it, I love it, I love it. Well, we'll be back in just a moment. I want you to meet a few other young men. We are back. I am back. Gentlemen, give my audience your names.
My name is Bowanda Miller, a.k.a. Bo.
What did I ask you to do? Speak.
You said speak up. That's what it
is. Speak louder. And don't. You don't have to. That, you see the rappers holding them like that. Yeah. Just speak up and Bowanda?
Yes.
Oh, okay. And?
Michael.
Michael.
Javier.
And Javier. So how you doing, gentlemen?
Good. How you doing?
Oh, I'm doing great because I love young people. Now, tell me, Bowanda, what grade are you in? What position do you play?
I'm going to the ninth, and I play small forward.
Small forward.
And I'm going to the 11th, and I play power forward.
Power forward.
I'm going to the 10th, and I play point guard.
Point guard. Oh, Stephen Curry. I still talk. Isaiah Thomas. I go back in the day to Legends, to the Legends game. All right. Gentlemen, what do you like about Change the Mentality? And before you go, before we even talk about that, these shirts are wonderful. Everyone, you should feel them. That's why I keep on touching them. I'm not trying to just touch the guy, but the shirts are so good. Who's the sponsor of these shirts?
Ain't it like the Black Athlete or something?
Yes, that's his name. Black Athlete.
The Black Athlete. Well, these are nice, and they donated these, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah, well, that's great. What have you liked about playing for this team, Javier? Loud and clear,
Doc. This is my family. Like, it ain't nothing. I could be myself around them. We just comfortable with each other.
What about you?
I just like being around them. Like, to them, for real, it's like they're my little brothers. I like being around them a lot, stuff like that.
Right. And what about you, Bowanda?
Same. I just like being around them. I can just be myself.
So what do you want to do after you get out of college?
Well, of course I want to go to the league, but if it don't work out, I'll just be an automotive engineer.
Automotive engineer? What about you?
Like, I wasn't thinking that far yet. I don't really know yet.
Well, start thinking about it because, you know, once you get into 11th grade, 10th and 11th grade, it goes by just like that. Okay, what about you?
Own my own business.
Own your own business. You don't know what the business would be yet.
No.
Okay, tell me, what was your tightest game? Who can just give me the narrative about your tightest game, the game that you really thought you might lose, but you ended up winning? Who can talk about it?
Me.
Loud and clear.
At the Casadon. We played this one team. They came out strong. We was lacking. And we had to go overtime. And we won by a buzzer beater. I think it's like the first point wins.
Yes.
That's the toughest game we had.
A buzzer beater.
Yeah.
You know, it's one of those things. So did you all have to come back?
Yeah. Defense. We had to play a lot of defense.
Who's your, there has to be a basketball player that you admire, that you kind of pattern yourself after. Can you tell me who?
Colin Sexton.
Colin Sexton. What about you?
KD.
Oh, Kevin Durant. Mm-hmm. All right. What about you?
Michael Porter Jr.
Michael Bird?
Michael Porter Jr.
Oh, Michael Porter Jr. What team does he play for?
The Denver Nuggets.
You know, I noticed that none of you mentioned any Pistons players. Oh, Lord.
K-Fielder.
Who?
K-Fielder.
I don't know.
He in the G League right now for the Pistons.
Oh, he's in. Is that a developmental league?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. What do you think about the Pistons?
They all right.
They're all right.
I'm not a big fan.
Well, they have a new coach. Back in the day, they had a lot of fans. I was a fan. I knew all the people who were playing. Now, I don't know anybody. Except I heard of Drummond. But I'd like to have him come on the show if anybody's watching. But anyway, neither here nor there. So what do you have in store for this school year?
I hope I do very good and stuff like that.
In your classes?
Yes.
What's your favorite class?
Math.
Math. Oh, wow. You must be smart. What's your favorite class, Javier? Put your mic up.
Reading,
reading. You know, that is so important because you got to be able to comprehend what you read, be able to repeat it back. What about you, Buana?
Science.
Science. Oh, me and Javier are in the same profession, and you two are in the same profession because I like reading and English. Well, if you have a good teacher, that makes all the difference, doesn't it?
Yeah.
He's a yeah. So, how do you balance schoolwork and basketball? Why don't you tell me how you do that? What do you do? What's your pattern?
Well, you just got to work hard at both.
Yeah.
It can't be lopsided.
Do you go to practice after school and then go home and study or what? Tell us.
This high school season, like, we had 20 minutes at the end of the class, so I just do it in class, so I won't have to worry about it after practice.
Yeah. What about you?
I probably take home for homework and then like bring it back the next day.
Yeah, homework. I believe in homework. I don't like it, but I believe in it. I think it's good.
Classwork.
Well, the thing about classwork is it reinforces your learning. If the teacher talked about this, that, and the other, and you read about this, that, and the other, then you do some homework. It kind of reinforces the learning so that when you take that test, because you all will be taking, you'll be taking the PS, you probably already took the PSAT. Oh, you're just going to 10th.
Yeah, you'll take it this year.
You're taking it this year. Well, you're going into 9th grade.
No, I got like a year left until I do that.
Yeah. How are your grades anyway?
Over 3.5.
3.5. Speak louder, Buana.
Over a 3.5.
Over a 3.5. Excuse me. Do you all want to talk about yours? No, I'm serious. Do you? I mean, that's really nice.
I like a 3.6.
Oh, my goodness. Okay, Javier, do you want to talk about it?
I did.
3.0, but that's good. Change the mentality. Has this team changed the way you thought about things?
Yes.
In what regard?
My mindset.
Oh, okay, your mindset.
Yeah.
In what regard? Like, tell me a little more.
Without changing mentality, I wouldn't, like, basketball wouldn't be my main focus. I'd be out with my friends doing stuff that's not illegal.
That's like, not illegal?
Yeah.
Right. Just hanging out.
Yeah.
What about you, Michael?
I don't know what I'd be doing if I never played for them.
Really? What about you, Buana?
Football.
Football?
If I wasn't playing for change the mentality, it would be more about football. But
you like football?
Yeah. But now it's about both now.
Well, I wish you and you guys, all of you, and Coach Foster, just the best of everything this season. I'd like to keep up with what you're going to be doing. I'm really proud of what you're doing. And I think you have a great future.
Thank you.
Because sports and academics together are... They help to thrust you towards the future, really. Well, everybody, we'll be back very shortly with Table Talk, but we have some interesting other guests this morning. So I will see you in a few.